Good morning. So, how are you doing? Good. Okay, so how are you taking the lessons that we have for the last 2 weeks? We have discussed the first key and the second key of to have a blessed life. And so, because this morning, we are now on the third week of our series on the 40 days of blessings. The series is about the Beatitudes. It is supposed to be our attitude as a followers of Christ. It's about learning what changes the Holy Spirit wants in our life to have a blessed life, not only for ourselves, but also so that we could also bless other people. And so this morning, we will talk about the third key, which is gentleness. Okay? So, are you gentle? Do you possess this character in you right now? But before we go, let's take a look at some of the historical figures that we have here in the screen. This is Adolf Hitler, the German dictator who, during World War II, was responsible for killing 6 million Jews. Napoleon Bonaparte, the French emperor who conquered Europe and part of the Middle East. And then we have Genghis Khan, the Mongolian emperor who conquered China and part of Eastern Europe. And of course, we have Alexander the Great, the Macedonian king who, during his time, created the largest empire in the ancient world. And of course, we have the Caesars of Rome who had his share of conquest. My question this morning, what is one thing in common among these men? What is one thing in common among these men? Well, these men attempted to conquer the world, but they all failed. Though they controlled huge armies and had great power at their commands, they did not have rule over their own spirit or over their own soul. And so in the end, their kingdoms were lost and they were ruined. On the contrary, our Lord Jesus Christ, he had no servants, yet they called him Master. Had no decree, yet they called him Teacher. Had no army, yet kings feared him. And won no military battles, yet he conquered the earth. What a paradox. And so he said this word to us this morning in Matthew 5, verse 5, "Blessed are the meek, for they will inherit the earth." So here Jesus is simply saying us, happy are those who are gentle. The whole earth will be theirs. They will possess the land. Not only the here and now, but also the new earth that would come that is mentioned in Revelation 21, verse 1. So this morning, we will look at two key points. Number one, what is being gentle? And second, what are the benefits of being gentle? And of course, we will touch this text in Matthew chapter 5 and Genesis chapter 26. So why Genesis 26? Because we will look at a life, an Old Testament figure in the name of Isaac, so that we could understand better what is gentleness is. And so I'd like ask everyone to please stand up as we read a portion of Genesis chapter 26, verse 12 to 17. Kindly stand up as we commit this time to the Lord. And let's read together Genesis chapter 26, verse 12 to 17. Now Isaac sowed in the land and reaped in the same year a hundredfold. And the Lord blessed him. And the man became rich and continued to grow richer until he became very wealthy. For he had possessions of flocks and herds and a great household. So that the Philistines envied him. Now all the wells which was his father's servant had dug in the days of Abraham his father, the Philistines stopped up by filling them with earth. Then Abimelech said to Isaac, "Go away from us, for you are too powerful for us." And Isaac departed from there and camped in the valley of Gerar and settled there. Let's pray. Father God in heaven, we thank you, Lord, for this time. Thank you for your presence, O God, even for this wonderful place that we have. We pray, Father, as we humble ourselves, that you will open our hearts and our mind. Speak to us, Lord, this morning in simple and clear ways so that we may learn to walk in a manner worthy of our calling. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Kindly be seated. So the title of our message this morning is The Strength of Gentleness. And I'd like to give you a take-home reminder. So don't react, respond in meekness. Can you tell the person beside you and tell this reminder so that when we go home later, we will have something to take home, no? Don't react, respond in meekness. Okay? So going back to Matthew chapter 5, verse 5, here Jesus simply is telling us that God blesses those who are gentle, and the whole earth belongs to them. Do you really believe this? Do you really believe this? When you are gentle, the whole earth will belong to us. Of course, we need to believe it because Jesus never lies. Those who are gentle will inherit the earth. Okay? Because in today's hard-driving, aggressive, and self-promoting culture, we don't hear much anymore about gentleness, right? Because people think when you are being gentle, you are weak. Well, nothing is farther from the truth, because the Bible says, God's words say that it's not. Moses was described in the Bible as the meekest man on earth in Numbers chapter 12. Yet, we know that he is not weak. He is one of the great leaders in the Bible. Even people today thought that being arrogant, prideful, being mean, even gossip is being strong and a ticket to go ahead. Of course not. These are signs of weak people, people who are insecure because at the end, they all lose. They often end up being lonely because nobody wants to be with them, right? So they think that they possess the world, but actually the world is possessing them. So the Bible tells us that the truly strong people in life are the gentle because they have control over their own spirit. And we will learn that as we go along as to why. Okay, so let's go to the first point. What is being gentle? Well, being gentle is simply strength under control. That's being gentle. Gentleness is strength under control. It is absolute power under God's perfect control. It's the strength, it's the submission of our strength, like the status that we have, the position that we have, the influence that we have, and submission of this and our will to God's control and purpose, not only for ourselves. The word gentleness came from the Greek word prostes, which describes a wild stallion or wild animal like this stallion that is tamed. So why horse? Why of all animals the horse was used? Well, because the horse is a picture of strength. Do you know the strength of one horse? It's around 33,000 pound foot per minute, which means that a horse could lift up a weight of around 33,000 pound in 1 foot in 1 minute. So that's how strong a horse is. If you have to check our mind, that's around 300 bags of rice at 50 kilo per bag. So that's how strong the horse is. And this is where we get the term horsepower, which is the unit to measure power. So when the horse is tame, it did not lose its power. It has only become obedient. It is practically strength under control. And that strength that is bottled up is for its master's use. Okay, so how do these horses or wild horses tame? Well, first, feed them well until they are full. And then second, Second, mount them repeatedly until they no longer box out the rider or had the sign to resist. Then the horse is tame. So likewise in our spiritual life, true gentleness is only possible when you and I are connected to God. Not only being connected to God, but when you and I are abiding daily, which means that we surrendered and continue to surrender daily in the Holy Spirit and His Word. So that's being true gentleness. My question this morning, are you tame? Are you truly gentle? Because there are two reasons I'd like to share with you this morning why we should be truly gentle. Number one, because gentleness is a fruit of the Spirit that brings us under God's control. Galatians chapter 5, verse 23, but the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, forbearance, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, and gentleness, and of course, self-control. So, it is a part of the fruit of the Spirit. Not only that you will just choose gentleness, but we should also choose every component of the fruit of the Spirit, like joy, love, and others. So it's a part of the fruit of the Spirit. And they say that gentleness is God's cure for pride, arrogance, and selfishness. The second reason why we should be truly gentle, because Jesus values gentleness, because He is gentle Himself. Matthew 11:29 says that Jesus said, I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. Okay? So, as followers of the Lord Jesus Christ, we are meant to be gentle. We are designed to be gentle, and we are called to be gentle people. Do you agree with that? Do you agree that we are called, we are meant, and we are designed to be gentle as followers of the Lord Jesus Christ? Because Paul exhorted when he said in Ephesians chapter 4, verse 1 and 2, I urge you to live a life worthy of the calling you have received. Be completely humble and gentle. Not partially, not 10%, but 100%. Be completely humble and gentle. But sadly today, many people or many Christians or a lot of Christians are struggling with gentleness. Are you? Are you struggling with gentleness? And in the context of gentleness, I'd like to borrow the words of Michael Jordan, because some people want it only, no, to happen in their life. Some wish it would happen, but others make it happen. So which one are you? Do you just want to be gentle, but you cannot do it? Or wishing only? Or you really make it happen? Because those who make it happen clothe themselves with gentleness. In Colossians chapter 3, verse 12, it says, as God's chosen people. So Christians are God's chosen people. Holy, set apart, dearly loved, therefore clothe yourself with compassion, kindness, humility, gentleness, and patience. So as God's holy people, we should clothe ourselves. We should remove anything that hinders our being one of this, what is described here. And so, why we should be this? Because Galatians 2:20 says that we no longer live by ourselves. Okay? It says here that I've been crucified with Christ and I no longer live, but who lives in us? Christ lives in me. The life I live in the body, I live by faith in the Son of God who loved me and gave Himself to me. So therefore, this is just a matter of obedience. Okay? Because remember, the gift of God, what is the gift of God to us? Eternal life. What is our gift to God? It's our obedience. And very interestingly, the word obedience has 9 letters. And what is the middle? I. It's the letter I. And the 2 letters between I is D and E. So therefore, in order for us to obey God, we should first die to self and then make Christ very much alive in our life. And so therefore, if we are in Christ, we have to pursue what God approves of. And these are a godly life, faith, love, endurance, and gentleness. So, are you being gentle? Are you pursuing the things that God wants us to pursue? What are you pursuing this morning? Are you pursuing the things of the world, or are you pursuing the things that God wants us to pursue? I remember Francis Cong when he said this, that what you pursue really possess you. So be careful what you are pursuing. And so here in 1 Timothy 6, it's saying that we are to pursue what God's approved. And one of these is being gentle or gentleness. And of course, we have a model, which is Christ himself, because he is the ultimate model of gentleness. And he is the ultimate God. And with all his power and might, yet Christ remained gracious and gentle to us. And I like us to take a glimpse of our gentle God this morning with this video. Let's watch this.
In Genesis, Jesus is the ram at Abraham's altar. In Exodus, he's the Passover lamb. In Leviticus, he's the high priest. In Numbers, he's the cloud by day and pillar of fire by night. In Deuteronomy, he's the city of our refuge. In Joshua, he's the scarlet thread out Rahab's window. In Judges, he is our judge. In Ruth, he is our kinsman redeemer. In 1 and 2 Samuel, he's our trusted prophet. And in Kings and Chronicles, he's our reigning king. In Ezra, he is our faithful scribe. In Nehemiah, he's the rebuilder of everything that is broken. And in Esther, he is the Mordecai sitting faithful at the gate. In Job, he's our redeemer that ever liveth. In Psalms, he is my shepherd and I shall not want. In Proverbs and Ecclesiastes, he's our wisdom. And in the Song of Solomon, he's the beautiful bridegroom. In Isaiah, he's the suffering servant. In Jeremiah and Lamentations, it is Jesus that is the weeping fourth man in the midst of a fiery furnace. In Hosea, he is my love that is forever faithful. In Joel, he baptizes us with the Holy Spirit. In Amos, he's our burden bearer. In Obadiah, our Savior. And in Jonah, he is the great foreign missionary that takes the word of God into all of the world. You go on and you see in Micah, he is the messenger with beautiful feet. In Nahum, he is the avenger. In Habakkuk, he is the watchman that is ever praying for revival. In Zephaniah, he is the Lord, mighty to save. In Haggai, he is the restorer of our lost heritage. In Zechariah, he is our fountain. And in Malachi, he is the Son of righteousness with healing in his wings. In Matthew, thou art the Christ, the Son of the living God. In Mark, he is the miracle worker. In Luke, he's the Son of Man, and in John, he is the door by which every one of us must enter. In Acts, he is the shining light that appears to Saul on the road to Damascus. In Romans, he is our justifier. In 1 Corinthians, our resurrection. In 2 Corinthians, our sin bearer. In Galatians, he redeems us from the law. In Ephesians, he is our unsearchable riches. In Philippians, he supplies our every need. And in Colossians, he's the fullness of the Godhead bodily. In 1 and 2 Thessalonians, he is our soon coming King. In 1 and 2 Timothy, he is the mediator between God and man. In Titus, he is our blessed hope. In Philemon, he is a friend that sticks closer than a brother. And in Hebrews, he's the blood of the everlasting covenant. In James, it is the Lord that heals the sick. In 1 and 2 Peter, he is the chief shepherd. In 1, 2, and 3 John, it is Jesus who has the tenderness of love. In Jude, he is the Lord coming with 10,000 saints. And in Revelation, lift up your eyes, church, for your redemption draweth nigh. He is King of Kings and Lord of Lords.
So praise God, no? Just remember, if our God is not gentle and He is not gracious to us, I think none of us would be here in this room. He was so gentle that that's what He declared in Matthew 11, verse 29. And so let's go. What's the title of our message this morning? The title of our message this morning is The Strength of Gentleness. And what's our take-home reminder? So don't react, respond in meekness. Okay? So let's go to the second point for us this morning. What are the benefits then of being gentle? So if we pursue gentleness, if we are gentle, so what are the benefits that we could have, no, of being gentle? Okay? So let's take a look of a character in the Old Testament, from the Old Testament Bible, Isaac. And so that it would help us see how this man respond, no, in gentleness. So who is Isaac? Well, Isaac is the son of Abraham. His name means laughter. And he was described in the Bible as the absolute gentle and patient man. As a young boy, he was a trusting yes father when he was offered as a sacrifice in the altar, and he has a quiet walk with God. He loves to meditate, to pray usually in the field in the afternoon. And he lived quietly with one great love, Rebecca. You know, as a young man, he simply accepted, no, the woman whom he will marry, and he dug well. Probably he is hardworking, increased greatly in the earth, peaceable with his neighbor, and of course, this is the most important thing, he was firm in his reliance on God to the divine promise given to his race. That is Isaac. And what is the background of Genesis chapter 26? Well, here, Isaac was facing a problem. There was famine in his place in Beer Lahai-Roi. So he decided to go to Gerar, north of where he is. And then after arriving in Gerar, Isaac and Rebekah were tempted to go south to Egypt. But God said no. God told Isaac to remain in Gerar and promise that God will bless him there. So now let's go to the first benefit of being gentle. It says here that gentleness diffuses conflict. Gentleness diffuses conflict. If you are being gentle, it diffuses conflict. So let's look at the life of Isaac. In verse 12, it says, "Now Isaac sowed in the land and reaped in the same year 100-fold, and the Lord blessed him. And the man became rich and continued to grow richer until he became very wealthy, for he had possessions of flocks and herds and great household, so that the Philistines envied him. Now all the wells which his father's servant had dug in the days of Abraham his father, the Philistines stopped up by filling them with earth. Then Abimelech said to Isaac, 'Go away from us, for you are too powerful for us.' And Isaac departed from there and camped in the valley of Gerar and settled there." So what's the scenario here? The Philistines were jealous of Isaac because he had grew to be very, very rich in spite of the famine in the place. So they block up Isaac's well in verse 15. Isaac here could have fought, because he has a large household. He has army, by the way. And just as like his father Abraham in Genesis chapter 14, he could have even claimed his divine right and used his strength to stay in the land when King Abimelech asked him to go. But he chose to respond in faith in the attitude of gentleness. What did he do? In verse 17, Isaac departed from there and camped in the valley of Gerar and settled there. Why? Why did Isaac did that? Because Isaac saw God in the big picture over the circumstances. So how about us? So by responding in gentleness, Isaac made a bad situation became better, not worse. Why? Because he avoided quarrel with the Philistines. In Ecclesiastes chapter 10, verse 4, a quiet and gentle spirit can overcome even great mistakes. Even for those people who had hurt us or who irritates us, a quiet and gentle spirit can overcome even great mistakes. So, which do you care most? No? Which do you care more about? Demanding your rights or displaying right choices? When people like King Abimelech comes to you, which do you care most? Demanding your rights or displaying your choices? Because a person who reacts demands his or her right to be right, no matter who gets hurt. Okay? But the person who responds is more concerned about making right choices before God. Because a person who responds wants to honor God, wants to glorify God in his life. So, question this morning, which one are you most of the time? So, which one are you most of the time? Because the golden rule for those person who reacts is this: do to others as they do to you. If they shout at you, you shout back. So that's what it means. But to those who respond, which is and have an attitude of being proactive like Jesus, do to others as you want others to do unto you. Again, my question this morning, which one are you? Are you a person who reacts, or are you a person who responds in faith in the attitude of gentleness? And I like the words of Max Lucado. He said this, "I choose gentleness. Nothing is won by force. I choose to be gentle. If I raise my voice, may it only in praise. If I cleanse my fist, may it only in prayer. If I make a demand, may it be only of myself." It is my prayer that this should be our attitude as followers of the Lord Jesus Christ. You know, gentleness not only diffuses anger, gentleness disarms critics. So this is the second benefit of being gentle. And I like the rule or the mantra of self-defense. It says here that keep calm and disarm them. So it's like this, when you are gentle, you disarm your critics. You disarm your critics. So like Isaac, the more successful we are in life, the more critics we're going to have. Have you ever experienced that? So who are these critics? These are the people who gossips us against us at work, in our neighborhood, or in businesses, or in school, the people who malign us and who say bad things against us. So how do we handle the critics in our life? Do we tend to retaliate when we are hurt? Do you do that? Do you retaliate? Because Paul said in 1 Corinthians 4:13, we respond gently when evil things are said about us. So we should respond gently, and we should respond in faith in the attitude of gentleness. So here's the point. When you respond in gentleness, it disarms our critics. In other words, we don't retaliate, we don't get back at them. So that's being gentle. That's being a gentle person that Christ wants us to be. And so here, what was Isaac's response? In verse 18, then Isaac dug again the wells of water. So remember, he was asked to go out from this place because he became very rich. And so Isaac departed. What did he do next? He simply dug again another well. So that was Isaac's response. And it was a avoidance of any quarrel. Because we know that Isaac was looking to God. Whatever happened in his circumstances, God has promised him to bless. God has promised him to bless him. So as Christians, we must always take the high ground. Okay? We must always take the high ground. If somebody hurts you And you get even, it puts you even with them, those who hurt you. But if you just dug again, which means respond in gentleness, it actually puts you morally superior to them. Okay? So I like what Jesus said. This is what we should do. But I tell you who hear me, love your enemies. Do good to those who love you. Bless those who curse you. Pray for those who mistreat you. If someone strike you in one cheek, what will we do? Turn to him the others also. If someone takes your cloak, do not stop him from taking your tunic. Give to everyone who asks you, and if anyone takes what belongs to you, do not demand it back. And then in verse 13, do to others as you would have them do to you. So this is what Isaac did. Now he responded in gentleness to his enemies because that is what he wants his enemies to do also to him. And if we do this, Jesus said, you may be the sons of your fathers in heaven. Okay, so that's who we are. That's how we are designed. We are designed to be gentle people. And number three, gentleness is persuasive. Gentleness is persuasive. And I like the character of Chinese character of gentleness. I'll try to say the word. It's wun ya. Okay? Correct me if I'm wrong, but it's pronounced in Mandarin wun. Parang wun ya. Okay? So two words. It means gentle and pleasant. So that's the Chinese word for gentleness. Gentle and pleasant. When you are gentle, you are pleasant. You are pleasant both in words and in deeds. And of course, when you are pleasant, you are gentle. Because the ungentle, immature people are rude, they are crude, and quarrelsome, just like the herdsman of Gerar in verse 20. So Isaac did not react, but he always responded in faith in the attitude of gentleness. Let's take a look what Isaac did. In Genesis chapter 26, verse 18 to 22, then Isaac dug again the wells of water which had been dug in the days of his fathers Abraham when he was asked to go out from the place. And then in verse 19, his servant dug again. And then in verse 19, when the herdsman of Gerar quarreled with the herdsman of Isaac, saying, the waters is ours. Then in verse 21, they move out and then they dug another well. And then they quarreled over it again. And then in verse 22, they dug another well. One thing I observe here, wherever Isaac dug another well, there's always water. That's why the Philistines became more envied with him. And that's the blessing from God. Okay? So Isaac did not say anything. By the way, so as they were digging waters, they were moving down south to Beersheba. And this is actually the place God wants them to go. So sometimes in our life, when bad circumstances comes into our life, we must always respond in faith in the attitude of gentleness because we really don't know how God is moving in our life. So here, in verse 22, finally, when the herdsman of Gerar did not quarrel with them, Isaac said this word, at last, the Lord has made room for us, and we will be fruitful in this land. So you see, we did not hear anything unpleasant coming from Isaac. His words are pleasant because Isaac is a gentle person. In Proverbs 16:21, it says here, the wise are known for their understanding, and pleasant words are persuasive. So why did Isaac respond in gentleness? Because by faith, Isaac was relying on God's promises to him. Earlier on, chapter 26, in verse 3, God told Isaac these words, sojourn in this land, which means stay in this land, and I will be with you and bless you. For to you and to your descendants I will give all these lands, and I will establish the oath which I swore to your father Abraham. So just imagine yourself if you were Isaac, and then the Lord is telling you this. Would you have that kind of rest? Would you have that kind of rest that no matter what happened, no matter what circumstances we are in, God is with us and God will bless us. So that's the attitude of Isaac. Because true Christian always sees God in the big picture of our circumstances and people. There are no accidents in the lives of God's people. Do you agree with that? It's like in the Romans 8:20 that all things work together for good. So when we respond in gentleness, we don't quarrel, right? So it disarms our critics. And when our words and deeds are pleasant, it brings us to the number four benefit of gentleness, which is gentleness is attractive. So when you don't quarrel, your words are pleasant, it disarms your critic and you become attractive. So let's take a look again in Genesis chapter 26. One day, King Abimelech with his prime minister and the chief of their military came to Isaac. And in verse 27, Isaac asked, "Why have you come here?" Isaac asked, "You obviously hate me since you kicked me off your land." They replied, We can plainly see that the Lord is with you." Okay? So Isaac became attractive because he was gentle. And his enemy said this word to him, "We can see plainly that the Lord is with you." So here, Isaac's conduct during this conflict has made great impression on Abimelech, and they could also tell that the Lord was richly blessing him. So for Isaac, more important than possessing his wealth, having great wealth, was the privilege for him to witness his pagan neighbors. So how about us? So his enemies, King Abimelech and his officers, saw God in the life of Isaac. And our question this morning, can others see God in you by how you conduct yourself? Can they see that you are different? Can they see that you are a Christian, a follower of the Lord Jesus Christ? Can they say, "We can see plainly that the Lord is with you," or not at all? So you have to ask yourself, can they tell that you are a follower of the Lord Jesus Christ? So how does gentleness become evident? Here's a words from an unknown author. It says here that it is no necessary for us to say that we are meek. Our behavior and our words will show the people around us that we are meek. There's only one way to achieve meekness: devoting oneself to God daily. So let Him to cultivate this fruit of His Spirit in us. So remember that true gentleness is being connected with God. When you and I are connected with God and we are abiding in the Spirit and His Word daily. Okay, so gentleness is attractive because gentleness, which is our number five benefit, is gentleness communicates love. Gentleness communicates love. And going back to Galatians 5, verse 23, it says here that Paul begins with love, okay? But the fruit of the Spirit is love, because all of the other fruit is really an outgrowth of love. Here, love is the blossom through which the fruit of the Spirit is produced. If you could recall 1 Corinthians 13, it simply talk about the fruit of the Spirit. But Paul said there, "If I have not love, I gain nothing." So love is the blossom through which the other fruit is produced. And one of these is gentleness. For without love, there is no fruit. And gentleness is love touching. Gentleness is love touching. Without gentleness, love does not touch others. Without gentleness, our touch would be harmful, painful, and selfish. And I'd like to show you how this works, no? Gentleness communicates love through these two brothers, Harry and Charlie. Let's watch this.
Charlie bit me.
Thank you. So, if you are Harry, what would you do? Would you push your brother Charlie from the chair? So, that gentleness communicates love. Ephesians chapter 4, verse 2 says, "Be completely humble and gentle. Be patient, bearing with one another in love." Okay? Bearing with one another in love. And so here, so number 6, benefit of gentleness is gentleness earns respect. Okay? So number 6, benefit of gentleness is gentleness earns respect. So Abimelech acknowledged God's favor was upon Isaac before they could not recognize it. So in verse 29, Abimelech declared, no, to Isaac, "You are now, or you are blessed by the Lord." Because in Proverbs 16:7, it says here, "When a man's ways are pleasing to the Lord, he makes even his enemies live at peace with him." So here, he became attractive, and then here, because of the gentleness of Isaac, he became his enemy, or Abimelech respected him. Because Isaac did not use his power to stay in the land, but choose to respond in faith in the attitude of gentleness, he gained the respect. So God truly blessed Isaac, even the pagan king. Here Abimelech called him blessed. Isaac and the Philistine leaders were able to reach an agreement after this meeting, and they even dined together. The result, Isaac was at peace with his neighbor. So true indeed, in Psalms 37 it says, "But the meek will inherit the land and enjoy peace and prosperity." Why? What's the secret of Isaac's gentleness? The secret of Isaac's gentleness was his intimacy with God. He was connected with God. So remember earlier that true gentleness, when you and I are connected with God, and when you and I are abiding daily in the Spirit and His Word. Okay? So what's the title? And the object of Isaac's faith was not in his army, or in geography, or in the wealthy dog, but in God alone. Because God here is the blessing. So it doesn't matter where we are, even if we have all the possessions that we have, but the object of our faith should be in Christ alone, because God Himself is our blessing. So what's the title of our message this morning? The strength of gentleness. Because the truly strong people are those who are gentle, because they are under God's complete control. And what's our take-home things to remember? Don't react, respond in meekness. Okay. Number 7, gentleness is a witness to unbelievers. Okay, that is the 7th benefit of being gentle. The life of Isaac is an example for us to follow today. So would people around us say this word to us? "We saw clearly that the Lord was with you." Do people say this word to you? Do people recognize that we are different because of our being gentle? Because people today look at us Christians all the time. They're watching us to see if we are really different from them. Are we different, any different than they are when we are under pressure? Do we respond in gentleness when we are under pressure? Because when we respond to pressure with gentleness, that is an incredible testimony to the world. So again, can others see God because you are being gentle? You have to ask yourself, even I have to ask that myself. There was a true story of a man, an American missionary named Jim Elliot. I know some of you may be familiar with him. In February 21, 1952, Jim Elliot and his friend arrived in Ecuador with the purpose of bringing the gospel to the most primitive savage people on the face of the earth, the Uca Indians. You know, they spent so much time, years, to reach out this native tribe. And finally, one day, they were able to reach out to them. And they made friends with them. They gave food, they gave gifts to them. But in January 8, 1956, out of nowhere, without provocation, the Uca men came forward and attacked them with their spears. The five missionaries had guns in their camp, but they did not use them to fight the Indians. They knew that if they fight them, they could have saved their own lives. They have the power, but they held it even to the point of death for the sake of the lost, just like Jesus Christ. Just like Jesus Christ. So that day, five of them were all killed. But you know, the Ocas all remembered those five strange white men who had been so gentle to them and had not tried to kill them. And this forever changed their life. And you know, a year later, when more missionaries tried to speak to them about Jesus, they were now ready to listen. And several of these men who had killed Jim and his friends became Christians. And this is one of the leaders. And one of them became even the pastor of the tribe. And this guy over there, the right, is the son of one missionary whom they had killed. And this guy who became the pastor went around the world talking about missions. You know, after more than 50 years, even today, we still talk about these things. The gentleness of Jim Elliot and his friends have brought encouragement and inspiration to thousands of believers worldwide. So, brothers and sisters, let our gentleness be evident to all at all times, because the Lord is near. So, are you gentle? So, we need to be gentle so that other people may know Christ through our lives. And the last benefit that we're going to talk this morning is gentleness makes me like Jesus. Gentleness makes me like Jesus. You know, Isaac is a picture of Christ, gentle and obedient to his father, Abraham, even willing to be sacrificed, and as mentioned in Genesis chapter 22, like Christ. He had faith in God like his father, Abraham. You know, because those who are truly gentle are really like Christ. The truly gentle people does not make demands. Even for their position, their privileges in life, they don't make demands. And those who are truly gentle like Christ, they had complete absence of retaliation. Remember in 1 Peter, it says that, remember Jesus, when they hurled insults at them, he did not retaliate. When he suffered, he made no threats. And here also, those who are truly gentle people always are satisfied, content, but of course not complacent. So like Isaac, let us live within the spheres of God's blessing at all times. Let us focus on God, and then let us respond in faith in the attitude of gentleness. Because with this it will result to our obedience to God. So let us always be within God's sphere of blessing. So what's our message this morning? The strength of gentleness, and what's our take home? Don't react, respond in meekness. So this morning I'd like to end my message with this song. And let us try to listen to the message of this song, because this song is about the many situations we have in life, about the trials that we have and the challenges that we have in life. Let's listen to this music.
We pray for blessings. We pray for peace. Comfort for family. Protection while we sleep. We pray for healing. For prosperity. We pray for your mighty hand to ease our suffering. And all the while you hear each spoken need. Yet love is way too much to give us lesser things. 'Cause what if your blessings come through raindrops? What if your healing comes through tears? What if a thousand sleepless nights are what it takes to know you're near? What if trials of this life are your mercies in disguise? We pray for wisdom, your voice to hear. And we cry in anger when we cannot feel you near. We doubt your goodness, we doubt your love, as if every promise from your word is not.
Brothers and sisters, whatever situation we are in, whatever circumstances that we are in, let us always respond in faith in the attitude of gentleness. So what's our message? The strength of gentleness, then don't react, respond in meekness. Shall we pray? Father, I pray that we would take this lesson, Lord, we learned this morning to our hearts, O God, and truly make it alive, O Lord. Father, we ask, Lord, that may you just fill our hearts with your Holy Spirit, O God, that we may walk, Lord, as we go out from this room, to be that kind of person that you want us to be, gentle people, O God, so that other people will be attracted to us. And we will have that opportunity, O God, to share them about Jesus, O God, just like Jim Elliot and his friends, O God, even to the point that they offer their life. Lord, for those who are struggling here to be gentle, Father, help them. Touch them this morning, Lord, with your gentle spirit, O God. And may they hold on to you, dear Father, and seek counsel with you. And of course, for those who came here this morning and had not yet established that relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ, Jesus is telling us this morning, come to me, all of you who are weary and burdened. Take my yoke and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your soul. So anyone who had not come to the Lord Jesus Christ yet, make this your personal prayer. Say this with me. Lord Jesus, I know I am a sinner. I repent of all my sins. Please forgive me of my sins. I now accept you as my personal Lord and Savior. Thank you, Jesus, for the priceless gift of your salvation, which now I receive by faith in Christ's name. And for us here who have been coming here for many times, let us continue to serve the Lord. Let us continue to grow towards Christ-likeness, because this is the only way that we should be doing for the glory of God. Lord, we love you, Father, and may your name be glorified in our place, in this church, and may your name be magnified, Father, through our lives as we go out again another week ahead of us. Father, bless your people, Lord, as we come back again next Sunday. This we ask in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless us all, and good morning.